Please.
Thomas, vielen Dank für deine freundliche Einladung. Aber jetzt wechsle ich nach Englisch. Es braucht zu viel Zeit, wenn ich Deutsch rede. So, now switch to English. Also in this presentation, standardization is an important topic. And I will try to explain what I propose in the standardization of point cloud data. And you see here an important part of the standardization, and that is using a space-filling curve as a technique to manage the large point clouds. And what's also important here, that it's talking about ND point clouds, so three-dimensional point clouds, but there could also be other dimensions like the time dimension. It's joint work, was a whole group of people working on the point cloud research in Delft. And first, why I want to have, say, a database management approach. Today, it's more common practice to use specific file formats to store point cloud data. And there are libraries with functionalities that operate on these file formats, but actually, I think it's suboptimal. It's suboptimal for the reason that files are not designed to support multiple users. They're not designed to be scalable. The nationwide data set covering the whole Netherlands is about 60,000 different files. So first to figure out which files I have to use before you can work, that's also kind of inconvenient. Also, you want to integrate point cloud data with other data types, with vector data, raster data, alphanumeric data, and a database management system has capabilities of representing, querying all these different data types. You could build workarounds around files and have an advanced file system, but actually you are then building your own data management environment, and there is no reason why a database management system could not do it more directly and have a good format to represent point cloud or point cloud blocks. A small remark, point clouds are a bit similar to raster data in the sense that they are often sampling the real world. So as a result, when you do it in high precision, that gives a lot of data, big volumes, but also relatively static. You can sample again and again, but once you take a sample, you have to do the same effort to do the new sampling. They're also a bit like vector data in the sense that you can have any XY location and a point may have different attributes, for example, a classification or a color, RGB. So in that sense, it looks like normal vector data, but I still feel that it is different to these both representations. If you look at the ISO standards and the OGC standards, at the top level, at generic level, there are two types of spatial representations called the features and the coverages. Features more objects, coverage more continuum that is being represented. At the next level, when they are going to implementation abstract data types, you see the counterparts, the vector for the features and the raster or the grids for coverages. And I think we should include also point clouds as a representation here, because point clouds is more than just a data acquisition techniques from laser scanning or multi-beam echo. It's also something we can use to store the representation, to do analysis, routing computation or line of sight. We can also use it as visualizations to the end users on which decisions can be taken. So it should be there in the whole chain of data, spatial data processing. The third level of standardization is encoding level, and also there you see for all the types, raster, vector, point cloud, many different formats. I use the term ND point cloud to indicate that it is at least 3D space with X, Y, Z coordinates, but maybe other dimensions, and time is one of them. But and in addition to dimensions, you can have attributes, and I use the term attribute and dimension for things that are quite similar or the same. A point cloud is not only a scan of the real world. A point cloud can also be a collection of moving object data, because every time you move around, if XYZ time identity, XYZ time identity. And so also this point cloud data type is useful for representing these massive volumes of moving objects. Okay, that's the motivation. I hope you agree with me that point clouds are, say, a good way to represent spatial temporal things. I will now try to explain how we realize it in our research. So first the theory of ND point clouds, then a technique to make them efficient via space filling curves, spatially temporally coherent, the operations we think we need to work with them, a standardized interface to a database so we can be interoperable, we can change different databases, change different front ends and still work, and a conclusion. And here we see a list of people that collaborated in the past, and that includes also external organizations like Mike Orhammer from Oracle or Chinese people from Wuhan University. Okay, ND point clouds. The time dimension is obvious. So point clouds are used for monitoring things, the real world, and we could add time as a dimension. Also another important one is the levels of detail or importance level. If you have a large point cloud, it does not make sense to show all the points on your screen. You don't have that many pixels. So we try to organize them in levels of detail, so you can have overviews on one side and you can have intermediate views and detailed views when you're zooming in. And these levels of detail or scale could be seen as a stack of representations. And the higher you go, the more abstract or the smaller the scale is. And that level could be treated also as a dimension. So we have space, time and scale. That is our organizing framework. And that gives us, theoretically, 5D point clouds. Space, time, scale, 3 spatial dimensions, 1 temporal, and 1 scale dimension. Here's an example from a dynamic point cloud. So the coastline of the Netherlands is protected by sand dunes, so that's important for us. We want to stay dry. And it's very difficult to predict what is happening with these sand dunes. And there is an experiment with a huge depletion of sand for the coast, and that is monitored every day. A new laser scan is made both in the water and on the land side, giving huge volumes of points with time dimension. So this is a very clear example of a dynamic point cloud. This is what I tried to explain in words before. We try to organize the point clouds in a data pyramid. At the top, we have a selection of the points that give an overall representation of the whole area at the coarse level. And when we zoom in, we add detail. And this is actually how it's also done in raster data, but also for vector tiles. The drawback is that in this way we have discrete levels if we would organize them in such a data pyramid. But this is kind of the state of the art. Many viewers for large point clouds work like this. It's also a bit similar to, a quadtree structure or an octree structure. And if we look at this data pyramid, at the top the most important points, at the bottom all the points. Data-wise, it's a pyramid, but if we look at the whole area or domain, we see that the top is as wide as the bottom, because it's also covering the whole area, the whole country, but the data is more sparse. So the density is lower, so the deeper we go, the higher the density in the data pyramid gets. And this kind of ideal distribution, the factor 2, when you zoom in a factor 2, in a dimension, then you get, also a factor 2 more data. And this principle is applied also vector tiles, raster data. So try to apply this also to point cloud data. If we have it organized like this, then we can use this data pyramid, for example, for perspective view. Nearby, the viewer can show more detail because in the perspective there's more space on the screen. gradually further away can show less detail, and that results in viewers like this. This viewer is still online. If you use your Edge browser, you have access to 640 billion points of the Netherlands, so every square meter of the Netherlands about 10 to 16 points of 2 centimeter accuracy, and you can fly from Germany to the Netherlands and you see the whole country, bird eye view, but you can also zoom into a street in Delft and see the pavement and the difference between the sidewalk for the pedestrians and the road. And all kinds of features like vegetation are very well represented. But you also see the artifact, and on purpose I did not hide it over here, because with making thicker points I could hide that there is a density jump between nearby and further away data blocks. But this is what is actually being done. What I would like is to get rid of that, getting rid of the discrete levels and having a varioscale representation. So not a multiscale, but a varioscale representation. And for that, I would like to compute for every point an importance or a level value and assign it to the point as a new dimension. So we get x, y and important, or x, y, z and important, and then cluster on all these dimensions, x, y, z and importance. And cluster means putting things close together which are similar, either in space or importance, and or in space importance, so it is being balanced. My data cube is filled with this point cloud with importance values added, and now the vertical dimension is the level of detail or importance dimension. At the bottom there are all the points, a lot of points, also unimportant points. The higher you go, only the less the more important points you get. And when you are viewing from nearby to far away in a perspective view, you gradually select only the more important points. So nearby you have them all, and you will not get any data density jumps, these artifacts. So this is the motivation. So after the voxel grid vector object representation, now I have a third mature representation called point clouds or endpoint clouds, not only for geographic applications but for any spatial temporal domain. It could be medical applications or physics, astronomy, hydrology, CAD systems, wherever space and time are important to represent, you could use this kind of modeling. A deep integration of space, time and scale is efficient, and it offers also additional functionality. For example, the perspective view or smooth zooming is efficient because I can now select at the same time both on location and on time and on scale. If they are different attributes, location, scale, time, and I put different indexes on them, different organizing structure, I have to choose which one is the most selective. Space, okay, but then time is forgotten in that selection. When I deeply integrate space, time and scale, I can specify them all at once and have, say, the optimal answer. So the point cloud should be used throughout the whole processing chain, from acquisition, storing, analyzing, simulating, disseminating visualization as a mature type. But it's big data, and the data set I showed is 640 billion is not even the biggest. There are even far bigger data sets. Up to 35 trillion points have been reported, and that's really a lot of data. It's easy to say in a few words, but a lot of data. Space filling curves. I decide what I call organizing the dimensions and what I call attributes which I want to add to them. The dimensions are the main drivers for data organization, for the clustering, for the indexing, the subdivision, useful for parallel processing, but also useful for compression or blocking or caching when streaming the data to from the server to a client. There are many techniques possible to do this data organization. But I will now look at the space filling curve. Yeah, this is the challenge. I have a data cube, an ND data cube with points. How should they be stored in the memory of a computer? The first one, the vertical dimension is the main organizer. Assume that that would be time. Then that this is a time slice. In the second middle example, location is the main organizer. And on one location, it's rather easy to find all values. And in the third representation, I try to put together both the spatial location and the temporal location in one data block. But it's a trade-off, it's balancing. And the hypothesis is that, say, mixing these dimensions is a kind of overall best solution. So in this framework, we have to support the modelers with tools to decide what are dimensions, what are attributes, how to encode a point in a space-filling curve key. There are different mathematical techniques, a Morton code, Hilbert code. The dimensions are of different nature. For example, space is in meters and time is in seconds. So what does 1 meter mean to 1 second? I have to scale. That will influence my clustering. Do I want to apply compression techniques? So I need a kind of environment, a workbench to specify this. The space filling curve, it's an old mathematical technique to map, say, a curve passing, which is a one-dimensional primitive, passing through every point in a space, 2D space, 3D space, in a systematic manner. And here is the Morton and the Hilbert curve being displayed. And when you continue with enough refinement, you will pass any point in the space, in the 2D or the 3D or in the 4D space. So every point gets a key. That's the number they have in the curve. That is the SFC key. When you store the key in a database, you can put an index on it to do fast querying. And if you use an index organized table, that means that the index and the data itself are one structure. Normally you have the data and you have the index, and the index is pointing to the data. And when you have point clouds, both structures are rather large. If you have one structure, an index organized table, that is very efficient. So I convert my points into SFC keys. When I'm doing queries, spatial queries, temporal queries, I have to rewrite my query geometry into a number of space filling curve key values that correspond with that location. If you look at the space filling curve, it is a kind of an hyper cube. It can be an ND space. And it is based on a quadrant recursive refinement. And that is very similar to octree, quadtree approach. So there you get the spatial coherence or temporal coherence. In Oracle, if I would have computed the space filling curve key, I could define a table and say, okay, I have the Horton or Hilbert code, and that's my primary key, that's it, and the organization is an index, and that's all. And that's a very simple, efficient structure. Postgres does not have this structure. I can define the table containing the same key. Afterwards, I can have a second statement, but that had to do the clustering on this this key, but it needs two structures, so less efficient. Okay, what we learned in our work is that the index organized table is an efficient structure because it put the index and the key together. When we put the x, y, the z, and the scale or the time in the key, we can forget about them in storing it in addition, because the key contains also the x, y, z, a full resolution key. The drawback is full resolution key gets large. Actually, it's a combination or addition of all the individual dimensions. when we are doing encoding and decoding of the key values, we should do that inside the database, because already moving these amounts of data from one location to another location takes a lot of time. Doing computation, moving it back, is really wasting times. As said, it's application dependent what you call a dimension and what you call an attribute. You have to worry about the relative scaling of the dimension, a meter to a second. And okay, if you are in n-dimensional space, how do you specify your query? Okay, in 3D space, it's a polyhedron perhaps, but what does it become in 4D space? A polytope? Can a user specify a polytope? So we have to worry about that. And when we do a query, a geometry query, and we do a high resolution geometry query, we get a lot of ranges, and that makes it dangerous. And, speeding up, the operations, the encode, the decode. So encode is going from a point in a domain to a key. The decode is the other way around. I have the key, I'm in a domain, and I get back the point and the other dimensions, time or scale. And the range function is, I have a query geometry, I want to select in this area, in this time frame. In a domain, some data, it will give me the ranges of SFC values that correspond to that. And then some maintenance operations to create the structure and drop the structure. This is an encode, so I come with a point, I come with a domain. And this is the most simple encoding, the Morton encoding or piano key. And if you look at the X and the Y values, it is bitwise interleaving of the XY values that give you the SFC key. So that is a very easy computation. And also the reverse is very easy. It's just getting the bits in the right order again. And it works in any dimension, in 2D, in 3D, and 4D. The more tricky operation is the range. So I have a query geometry, for example, this polygon. I check, okay, which cells are being covered, and I can compare it to the quadri cells. Sometimes I cover a big area. That's convenient because that's a large range of keys at once. So that's the bottom part labeled here with zero. But sometimes it are also small parts. And that is a small range. I can put ranges together, because if I have a lot of ranges, that will be not so efficient to execute the query. To avoid getting too many ranges, I can stop recursion or the depth traversal early. And the second technique is merging ranges afterwards. Here's an example of a circle covered by these cells at a certain resolution. Then the second image is showing exactly the same circle, but now the 170 something ranges have been merged, but without adding space. But these are less ranges, so that is faster to query. In the next third image, I make some simplifications and I go back to 30 ranges. But in that, I add some space, and that is, yes, these red dots, they are added, because these ranges were not direct neighbors. Okay, I end up with ranges, and the query looks like this. Give me all the points where the space-filling curve key is between this value and that value. And that is then answering the query. Performance-wise, this gives me kind of constant response time, even if the data set size is growing. I compare it to having an index on X, Y, and Z separately and having the index on the space filling curve key. So started with 20 million, 200 million, 2 billion, 23 billion points. With the growing data set and the separate index, it was getting slower, because it had to choose which index. The integrated index on space filling curve gave me really constant query time, more or less. I explained about the balancing. There is no best balancing, depends on the queries, depends on the data. This is deeply integrated, and the other one is based on layers. what I explained in the operations is what I also propose as a standard database interface. So these are some people working together from Oracle, TU Delft. These requirements for the standard is that it should be flexible, should support many types of applications, so also moving objects and scans of objects. It should enable efficient implementations performance-wise, and it should be easy to use. So here is a refinement of the list of the flexibility requirements, the performance requirements, and the ease of use requirements. So the first thing we have is metadata, describing the point cloud, the domain, the resolution of these various dimensions. And we do it only once for a data set. So we know when we call a function, what is the domain, and we don't have to specify that again. And every dimension has a bit of own metadata. Then we have here a proposal for a standard interface, the SFC encode and the decode. Because the functions are called often, if you have 100 million or a billion points, you can think about bulk encoding and decoding. This is the interface for the bulk encoding, decoding. And the most tricky interface is the translation of the query geometry into the ranges. There are a number of parameters and options you can specify, such as the recursion depth or the max number of ranges which you want to have as an end result. This is how it's used, inserting first metadata. You create a point cloud table. You can query it and specify query geometry that has been encoded into ranges by the ranges function. And then you can select with the range function actual data. If you think back of the picture with the circle, there were two kinds of cells. There were cells that were completely inside your query geometry, and there were cells that were on the boundary. If you are inside a cell that is in the middle of the object, then you are sure that you qualify. If you're on the boundary, you are still doubting. You may be outside, you may be inside, and then you have to do, say, a second test. So you could report if you're in a boundary cell or in an interior cell. If you're in a boundary cell, you have to do a refinement test, which is shown over here. Okay, this was the idea of this perspective view. And the view frustum is what you select. So it's what I call a trans-dimension query, because it specifies space, but also scale in one higher dimensional primitive. And this is how this query would look like and translate it into SFC ranges. And you can also ask delta queries. I'm now at this position, I move a bit forward, I'm at a new position, I add some points and I drop some points. And these are the queries that will give you the added points and the omitted points. There are some drawbacks if you have high dimensional space filling curves, say 5D, 6D are possible, but your keys become very large, and it is also still an open research area. What is the price for putting all the dimensions together and in one structure? And so we can for sure say you will generate a lot of ranges when you do a query in six dimensions or five dimensions. Okay, we can try to reduce that with the parameters, the recursion depth and the max, but it's also the query precision that is then suffering. Okay, with this I want to conclude, especially given the time. I hope that you are convinced that ND point clouds will be in the future the third representation, completely used throughout the whole processing chain. And I will even put it stronger than this. It will be the main representation, used more often than the vector or raster data. Wait 10 years. And you will see point clouds more than vector or raster data. This is my prediction. I'm not sure if the 10 years is correct. They should be supported inside a database where we manage data, where we manage the other data, alphanumeric data, raster data. And we still have a lot of work to do to investigate what is an efficient solution. I talked mainly about points as individual objects to store. In reality, in practice, we should group the points to blocks that are coherent. And these are the units that are then used and shipped between the server and the client. And there is a need for standardization, not only at database level, but also at web services level. Thanks for your attention. This is some links to the code we made available. So if you want to reuse it, feel free to try to download and install it. And I think I should end given the time. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Peter, very much. I think this really shows that, yeah, it doesn't really make a difference if you're working with a point out of one scan or something. But if you really think about very large point clouds, about entire countries, or even increasing the resolution further, or having additional dimensions, which basically requires new sophisticated methods to organize them in a field.
Your management challenge becomes indeed bigger and bigger. So you start with a single scan, okay, a file is fine, but then a whole country, okay, getting tricky. And then you do the country again, or you refine the city.
Just one question. Yes.
You said that it's crucial if you mix all the dimensions to scale them. You mentioned the example of time and space.
Yeah.
In your proposal of the database interface, is this transparent to the user, or where is the scaling defined?
Actually, the data modeling, the data modeler is taking these decisions, but he has to analyze, okay, what are the actually the most important queries for the users. You cannot give an answer that is best for all situations, but if you have, say, the time attribute and the point as separate attributes, you can put on both an index. But only one of the indexes can then be used, and that actually means that you filter either on time, if that is very selective, that can be very good, or you select on location, but you cannot do both. And so after the first filter, you then have to check, okay, which is then passing my second criterion. And when you integrate it deeply into one value, this SFC key, then you can both select on space and time together, and that is for sure much faster, and with the growing volumes, that is very important. So that is the motivation.
That's a part, okay, yeah.
Do I have well understood that the points of your point clouds are always vertices in a regular n-dimensional grid?
It's not really a grid, but of course the machine is finite. And we have no real numbers, so we've only 64 bits, that gives a finite number of possibilities. So in that sense, you could say it becomes a grid again, but in principle they are zero-dimensional primitives, so no cell size in principle. But okay, here we are approaching the digital representations, which is finite. But in principle they are zero-dimensional primitives in an n-dimensional space. In implementation, okay, they become discrete numbers also. We don't have infinite numbers.